Sí.
Professor Teusink, please, you can start with your questioning.
Thank you very much. Dear candidate, first of all, this is one of my first online meetings, so it's actually a bit strange, and I didn't hear much of what happened. But let's start. I was really intrigued by your thesis, and I really read it with joy. And I have to say, especially chapter two, where there's lots of things happening during the cell cycle, and I was really intrigued. And I think most of the questions will probably be about that chapter. So let's start with actually the question that you pose. If I may rephrase or cite you, you say, the question is, what causes the metabolic oscillations? That is the thing you set out to try to do. And it actually reminded me of my own PhD when I worked actually at glycolytic oscillations, so with frequencies of 1 minute or so, so completely different dynamics. And then the question in the field was, okay, what is the oscillophore? So what is the thing that causes these things to oscillate? And we actually then said, well, there's actually no such thing as an oscillophore. Because it's a systems property. So the first question actually is, do you think that is actually the right question to ask? What causes the oscillations?
Hello, net opponent. Thank you for your nice words about my thesis. I think it is a right question to ask. I'm not asking a question about the specific pathway or an enzyme that creates the oscillations. What can create the oscillations is a system. And it seems to me, after doing the analysis that we've done, that the oscillations are created by the temporal separation among the biosynthetic pathways, protein biosynthesis, lipid biosynthesis, temporally separated, and probably also imposing feedback interactions on each other. And then as a consequence, different biosynthetic pathways pulling on the core metabolism and affecting pathways there, and as a consequence, metabolites oscillating.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so it's actually a delayed feedback in a way, negative feedback perhaps, that is then causing these things to oscillate. So it's
Yeah, perhaps.
Okay, so it is actually the whole system in by itself that is in this oscillation. Okay. So actually, to talk about these metabolic oscillations, they are independent, apparently, this is also from earlier work, independent from actually the cell cycle, right? So if you, I don't think you did it, but earlier work from the group showed that if you block the cell cycle progression, that these oscillations continue. But my question is, if these oscillations, metabolic oscillations, are really caused by these, especially by a synthetic machinery, what would actually happen then with these cells? Do they become bigger? You know, what actually happens? You know?
Yeah, I wouldn't say that the metabolic oscillations are completely independent from the cell cycle machinery. The opinion, the idea that we hold in our laboratory is that the what's happening inside the cell cycle, it is the system of coupled oscillators, the cell cycle machinery in the form of the cyclin-dependent kinase together with the repertoire of different cyclins. On the one hand, different parts of this machinery, plus also the metabolic oscillator, which is the oscillator of the biosynthetic processes, and these different things working together in a coupled way.
Yeah, I understand, but now I remove one of the oscillators, let's say the cell cycle.
Yeah. What was observed is when cell cycle is arrested, halted, then an ADPH and ATP oscillations continue over time.
But also protein synthesis and the things you studied?
Yeah, this is not clear yet, so I can only speculate here. So it seems to me that the NADPH and ATP oscillations, so oscillations of metabolites in the core metabolism, they are a consequence of the flux imbalances that are caused by the protein and lipid oscillations. Mm-hmm. So what was observed in this work, if you can go to the supplementary material of the second chapter, specifically to the figure number S8 on the page 64. So here we show the single cell trajectories, page 64.
Yeah, you're a bit too quick for me, hang on, because I have to do this electronically.
Yeah, sure. 64, figure S8.
S8, okay, yeah.
So here we present the NADPH oscillations in single cells, single cell trajectories, in different perturbation experiments that we implemented. So specifically in A, these are the three single cells, the NADPH oscillating before the vertical black line. This is the normal condition. Then we add cyclohexamide. And you can see that the NADPH oscillations almost disappear, we can say. And also at the same time, the cell cycle machinery is halted because there are no more orange vertical lines, which are the budding events. So here we see that the cell cycle is arrested, but at the same time, there are no NADPH oscillations. And in the previous work to which you referred to, when cell cycle machinery was halted, there were NADPH oscillations continuing. So this is just an indication that the protein biosynthesis machinery can lead to the NADPH oscillations.
Yeah, okay, I got that. But okay, I was raised with the idea that there is, let's say, control by demand, sort of. So you make something if you need it. So if you, I can imagine that if you cannot, let's say, divide anymore, that there is some feedback that will actually stop the synthesis of all these components, and apparently that's not the case. Or maybe it didn't really show that, but at least if the oscillation of NADPH reflect that, then so I was really puzzled by that.
Yeah, but if we look at our body, the majority of cells that are creating us, they are not dividing, right? And still they are continuing to live, so they require some material and building blocks. And in a way, these non-dividing cell cycle arrested cells are comparable to them. So perhaps the oscillations is just the property of metabolism, so the necessary element of the temporal organization of it.
Okay. So then, because I would like to ask sort of more why questions, let's say during a PhD, you've spent all this time, right, looking at all the technical details, and now, okay, so So why do you think that we actually need these metabolic oscillations? So is it necessary for the thermodynamic constraint of your professor, or is it about space that you need in the cytosol for things? Does it allow you to grow faster? Anything, please enlighten me.
Yeah, but these questions are very hard, right? So the work that I did was mostly a descriptive work in this chapter, right, in which we found out these oscillations. And so we can only speculate here right now.
Please do.
Future work. So one can envision that this is the competition for the resources of the core metabolism, when different pathways, lipid biosynthesis and protein biosynthesis, they share the same precursors, for example, acetyl-CoA, and then there should be some kind of competition between these two parts of metabolism. Or indeed, what you refer to, the thermodynamic constraint, although there is no evidence so far for this, that it is the cause for the oscillations. There might be also some transcriptional regulation when some metabolite oscillations appearing as the temporal imbalances of fluxes, these metabolites at high concentrations, they can induce the transcription of genes in other pathways.
Yeah, but that's mechanism. I'm talking really about the why. Yeah, so in resource allocation, maybe can you grow faster if you do this temporarily? So
perhaps it is the case, because the evolution is the process of arriving to organisms that will divide faster, right?
Yeah.
That will multiply.
Yeah, so I mean, you've done a little bit of FBA in your thesis, right? A little bit of modeling. So would there be a way to actually answer these type of questions? So with an FBA type of approach, could you think of something there?
So we used FBA in this work in order to understand the flux distribution changes during the cell cycle as a result of the protein and lipid biosynthesis changes, right? And would it be possible? So the important assumption that we made was the quasi-steady state assumption, and this is the limitation of FBA, right? And for the purpose of getting the flux distribution, that was okay, but I would be very cautious to answer, to understand the question why with the type of FBA analysis.
But could you, because if it's a cell cycle, you actually know that you start with one cell and at the end you have two. Now for the yeast it's more complicated because the daughter is different from the mother, but let's say you have two of them, right? Two equal copies.
You could almost equal, yeah.
Let's say, modeling is always simplification, right?
Yeah.
And so you have two of them. So could you maybe say, okay, there are some constraints and I just want to, but I'm allowed to actually change these processes separately. Did you find some optimal strategy integrating, or let's say over that cell cycle time? I could imagine something like that is maybe possible.
Short answer.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so the strategy that we used, that was the assumption of the biomass production maximization. So, the problem with FBA is that we also need to come up with the proper objective function. And so
shorten the time of doing that. But I think we have to stop. Is that what I understood?
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Teuschink. The opposition will be continued by Professor Polman.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Dear candidate, also my compliments with your thesis. I was also particularly impressed by your chapter 2. Lots of data, lots of analysis. I must say, I've never seen a thesis chapter with figure legends as long as yours, at least in the original version. I think some of your figure legends were as long as the results section of a regular paper. That's really impressive. But before I get to this, some of these data. I would like to start with chapter one, where you say something about yeast cells on surfaces that behave differently from cells in solution. So planktonic state versus what I would call, well, in biofilms, we often call it a sessile state. And then you indicate that the cells that are on the surface, that they have a very different metabolism. Glycolysis is upregulated. Cell wall metabolism is altered. What triggers these changes when cells are on the surface? And would you call this a sessile state?
Hello, learned opponent. I do appreciate your opinion about my thesis. Thanks a lot. So indeed, in the first chapter, I presented an example of yeast cells attached to the surface that started to produce a lot of alcohol, ethanol, but also live longer. So there are different physical properties on the surface compared to the planktonic state. And there are systems known in signaling systems known in microorganisms that change the transcription of many genes when a cell is attached to a surface.
But what would be the signaling mechanism? So how do we get the signal from the surface to the cell?
Yeah, for example, via the change of the transmembrane potential through the plasma membrane. Or there might be a different local concentration of ions close to the surface, because different surfaces, they can have different charges, and this can also induce the signaling.
So I think in the case of Bacillus subtilis, there is evidence that this is indeed via the membrane potential. Is there evidence that that is the case for yeast as well?
Not that I'm aware of, but there is definitely a transmembrane potential regarding the yeast plasma membrane. It might be the case, although there is the additional difficulty or difference regarding the bacteria is that the yeast cells have a thick cell wall. So then the interaction with the surface might be different in that sense.
You have also used probes to measure or to estimate the membrane potential. Have you looked at differences between cells in solution versus cells on surfaces in terms of membrane potential?
Yeah, the probe that I used was to measure the membrane potential difference in mitochondria. Mm-hmm. And the only way to estimate this potential was to use by using the microscope and the microlytic device, right? So that was just one state that I used. I didn't have a comparison with something else, because it's impossible to use this tool with another device, only with Microsoft.
Yeah. Now, thank you very much. Let's move to chapter two. You measure lots of parameters from protein synthesis, lipid synthesis, or let's say a lot of the synthesis capacity you infer from certain types of measurements. So for instance, protein synthesis is inferred from the fluorescence of GFP. So what is your evidence that GFP fluorescence is really a good proxy of protein synthesis?
Yeah, so I don't think that it is the best proxy to estimate the protein biosynthesis trajectory. That's why we use two methods also. So the alternative method with cyclohexamide, and then the tracing GFP and cyclohexamide method, they showed the same picture. And that was for us a convincing evidence that indeed this is the correct pattern. And so in order to use GFP measurements for our purpose, we put the GFP encoding gene under the control of a foreign non-yeast promoter, a synthetic promoter. In that sense, we thought that we will grasp the waves of global protein biosynthesis. And that was a very good decision, because we noticed that using different promoters from different genes results in a little bit different trajectories of GFP. Like, for example, if we would use a TEF, one promoter, which is the promoter of the translational elongation factor, then the GFP production will peak only once in G1, whereas when we use the synthetic promoter, there were two peaks. But there is a big drawback in terms of using this. We also need to measure the volume, the total cell volume. And the yeast cell is not the is a tricky cell because it's asynchronous. There's the daughter. It is small in the beginning, and it's hard to assess its volume. So there is a period in the cell cycle when we cannot, when we are not very precise. So we don't know what's actually going on with a high level of precision. That's why this type of analysis is confounded, and that's why we need an alternative method. And that was the cyclohexamide-based method.
Yeah. Now clear. For glucose transport, you use 2-MBD glucose as a measure. And so my first question is, I didn't see the crude data, but was the fluorescence of MBD glucose in the cell really higher than the fluorescence of the surrounding medium?
Yeah, that was a very that's a good question, because if you look at the supplementary figure on the page 62, that is figure S6, so page 62, B subplot, this is the raw data, without the subtraction of the fluorescence in the field of view. So that's why it starts so high at 500. So we can assume that the autofluorescence is about 8. And then you can see that the first point after the pulse, it is just the for 514, so 14. The actual retained fluorescence after the pulse is not that high. You're right. And but still, we managed to find a pattern, the cell cycle dependent pattern. And at the time point when I wrote this thesis, there was only one experiment done, but we replicated this experiment twice more, and we got a similar pattern. So just by analyzing more cells and repeating this experiment more times, we can combat this small fluorescence retention.
But do you or did you expect a level of fluorescence in the cell that would be higher than that of the medium? I mean, I'm thinking of, because the transporters in yeast are all uniporters, so they would just equilibrate the sugar.
Yeah, I now understood. So you're probably hinting towards the facilitated diffusion. Indeed, there shouldn't be a high concentration of glucose or this analog inside the cell, because it should be smaller regarding the medium, because otherwise transport will be not so efficient. Mm-hmm. Because there is the gradient that allows this transport to happen.
But you also write in this part of the chapter that 2-MBD glucose is not metabolized. And I'm wondering how sure you are, because as far as I am aware, hexokinase is still capable of phosphorylating the sixth position of such a sugar analog. I'm wondering whether the sugar is not trapped inside the cell because of phosphorylation.
Yeah, I'm not sure about this. I just translated this word, this phrase from the paper in which this analog was characterized. But you're right. It's not clear what is the fate of this analog further. It might be, there is some evidence that indeed it's phosphorylated. But what happens next? The interesting thing is that if you still at this page 62, there's the decay of the fluorescence inside the cell. And that might be an indication of a metabolization of this fluorophore. On the other hand, that might be an indication of the reverse transport. So it's not very clear.
Mm-hmm. What's the fate. Thank you for the answer. Perhaps a last short question. In this section where you describe this, you refer to the NBD glucose measurements as rates of transport. Are you really sure that you're looking at the rates?
I think I'm sure, because I gave a pulse for all the cells, the pulse of the same time, and then all the cells having different glucose transport rates, they experienced this. So I guess that the acquired fluorescence, the delta fluorescence, is a proxy of the rate, because the time was the same.
Okay, I think I've used up my time. Thank you very much for your answer.
Thank you.
En ik geef het woord graag terug aan meneer de rector.
Thank you. The opposition will be continued by Professor Kortholz from Turkey. Today.
Thank you, Mr. Director. Dear candidates, I also really enjoyed reading your thesis. I'm really not a specialist in this area, but you gave a very nice introduction. And what I also really liked is the table on page 19, at least in the electronic version, where you summarized all current methods that were available at that time. And what I really liked in your thesis is that you really try to enlarge them. Basically this table by looking at different new techniques and some failed and some worked. And what I really liked is that you also put the one that didn't work in your thesis, and that's chapter 3. What I want to ask about that chapter is, I dipped a little bit in the literature you refer to, and it worked in several mammalian cells. This paper, some of them were in cell, all high impact papers. What is so different in yeast that it doesn't work?
Yeah, hallelujah, opponent. I'm very grateful to you for your words about the table. That was a lot of work to make it. I tried to write it mildly. So I blamed on the yeast intracellular environment. So we are not sure whether these sensor worked in the first place in those papers that you mentioned. So it's not clear. Although there might be indeed differences, the biophysical differences, different crowding in mammalian and insect cells, because this sensor was also used in the insect cells, and yeast. So different biophysical environments.
So you did write it down in a mild way, but would you make the statement that you think that the other papers may be not completely correct in using this sensor?
Yeah, I think there is not enough data for this to make this claim.
Okay. So,
because then I would need to repeat all their experiments by myself. And yeah.
Sure. What I found really surprising there is actually that you see some oscillation in the sensor, although it's not binding or it's not showing what you wanted to measure. So, do you think this is a general thing of FRET sensors? Because you were quite negative about the use of FRET sensors in general, or do you think this is a specific thing about this FRET sensor?
Yeah, again, there is not enough evidence for this. A statement whether it is a general trait of FRET sensors, but I just tried to summarize to give potential confounding factors that might influence the usage of FRET sensors in highly dynamically changing systems like cell cycle. So before, FRET sensors were mostly used on the population level, so the so-called pseudo steady state. And so it's just these sensors need to be further tested in the cell cycle domain. We need to test other sensors to check whether indeed there is the same pattern. You know, everything is confounded also by the lack of information on the maturation dynamics of the fluorescent proteins. So I listed the confounding factors, but again, I cannot say whether one of them is the explanation of this.
Yeah, so we also have used many FRET sensors, and I'm also not that happy with most of them. I mean, it's completely different and unrelated projects. But what we do often there is we try to measure in cell lysate to see how sensitive this sensor is. I couldn't find it back in your thesis. Did you try to, instead of measure in single cells, did you try to measure in a cell lysate and then see if you can detect an increasing amount of substrate or binding partner of the sensor?
Yeah, no, we haven't tried this. So we were ambitious with this sensor because we also thought that the lysate and the cellular environment, these are two different things still. So then we thought that maybe it is also the time that we could spend. So we can show that in lysate the sensor works, but then our usage is the cell, right? And the most important thing is that it works there. So we if it happened that our sensor, this sensor worked in yeast, then we would have moved further to the lycée to prove for sure. But now we see that we cannot use it for our purpose, so we abandoned this.
Good. No, completely clear. But happily, you also got a new tool working, and that's of course in chapter 4, and that's an RNA-based tool. What you described there very well is why you why your approach or approach of the team worked and all the different steps. But for me, this seems to be a tremendous amount of work to get one sensor. Do you think this is the future, that we can generate such a biosensor for all different compounds we want, or is that an illusion?
So actually, we wanted to prove that it is not an illusion, that it is possible to create such a sensor, because when Celex, the method to create an aptamer for any desired ligand was created, there was this hope that it would be possible to create such a sensor for anything. And then people actually started failing creating such sensors for intracellular metabolites. And this is our ambition, to show that actually it's possible to do this, possible to create an in vivo functioning RNA-based biosensor for a metabolite which is hard to control, whose concentration hard to control. So I think we managed to show this, and I have good hopes for future. But indeed, you're right that it is a very labor-consuming and time-consuming exercise. But you know, with the arrival of robots in future, that must be easier.
Good. In your last chapter, chapter 5, you give some ideas how to optimize this sensor further, that we can really start using it. However, I didn't now completely understand what would be your approach, because you said maybe we should change it to make it more a thread-like pair, but then you said, but we also have seen the limitations of threads, what we just discussed. So what would be your straightforward approach to now say I want to optimize this sensor further?
Yeah, so the exciting thing about this sensor is that it seems that we created the sensing part of it. So the part of binding the ligand to the RNA and transmitting, changing the conformation. Now the question is, what would be the best visualization, the actuation domain of this sensor? And for the population level studies, what we have right now, the protein expression based visualization, it is a good approach. But I already envision, when I move with this sensor to the cell cycle domain, there it will be very difficult, because the protein biosynthesis rates differ, then the maturation kinetics of different fluorophores is different, and then it will be a very noisy output. So there must be something, a different way of visualization of the conformational change of the RNA device that we developed. And I just mentioned that one of the potential ways is using the FRET, two proteins binding to this RNA, but yet indeed in chapter 3 we showed that FRET is not ideal. So maybe this way, there is not yet a way how to do it better, but it's future work. And the most important thing, we created the RNA device that transduces the conformational changes and the ligand binding.
Indeed, I think it's great work. A last question. You say, as one of the applications, you said you might be able to measure the flux in every cell and even in the whole body. What would be the advantage to know and the flux in every cell and the body? What would that tell us?
But I guess this is also, that would be a dream to know all the fluxes in all the cells of our body, because the flux is in the way, like in the end, determine our phenotype rather than the static levels, the metabolite levels, although they also play an important role. But flux is the dynamical feature. This is what shows what's going on right now inside this cell.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Kotholt. The opposition will be continued by Dr. Milias Argaitis.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Dear candidate, thank you very much also for this very, very well-written thesis. I enjoyed very much reading it. It's extremely clearly written. And I also enjoyed getting lost in the figure legends, figure captions, which were, at some point I didn't know, I couldn't tell if I was reading a text or a caption. It was extremely detailed. But overall, I was hard-pressed to find any typo. It was amazing. So thank you very much for that. Also, I mean, I'm familiar with some parts of his work and I find it very fascinating. I still have several questions related to these oscillations. This is a very big topic that cannot be exhausted, of course. So I would like to start with this, so go back to this. So in several places in your thesis, you make comparisons or analogies with the yeast metabolic cycle that has been measured in chemostats, and specifically with the work of Benjamin Tu. So what we have observed there is basically they separate different phases of a culture into respiratory or like fermentative, and then so they make several separations of the genes that are expressed in different phases and all this. And I see that basically you are in contradiction with what their results are showing, because in your D1, you have the least respiratory activity, which is basically the phase where they observe the maximum. And then I wanted to ask you, like, how do you explain these discrepancies? Like, how do you find this trend? What would that imply for comparing your results with theirs?
Very learned opponent. Thanks a lot for your words about the text and captions about my thesis. So this is a hard question to answer. It's hard to compare our results based on the experiments done in the microlytics device in the perfectly constant conditions, right? Mm-hmm. On the one side, it's hard to compare these with the chemostat data where thousands of cells are dividing and possibly also being in different subpopulations. Mm-hmm. And because there were indications that, for example, sulfides, byproducts of core metabolism, they can interfere with the respiratory chain and then affect the metabolism of the surrounding cells. Mm-hmm. So just on the level of the methodology, just because it's so different, it's hard to compare. And also it's hard to compare because our experiments are done on high glucose, and we think this is the more relevant condition if we think about the just long-standing health and disease applications, for example, cancer, in which cells are bathed with a lot of nutrients, right? So what we also noticed, there is the core metabolism might be is different when cells are grown under different conditions, whether there is glucose limitation or high glucose. So in that sense, it's hard to relate this. And also, I personally think that the previous work that was done in chemostats, since it is not on the single cell level, so it's harder to make conclusions there with regards to the cell cycle, because there are several confounding factors.
Right, I agree with this, but what actually triggered my question was your observation of the mitochondrial membrane potential, which was, I still have to find the figure, but it was found to actually be maximal in G1. And that's where I started thinking about this, because, I still cannot find, it's a figure 5, panel F, page 47.
47, yeah. But actually, this part is quite comparable, in my opinion, to the previous chemostat work. For example, Benjamin Tu science paper in the middle of zeros. There, the highest level of respiration was observed around just before budding. And, mm-hmm. and then, in that sense, we observed the highest potential there. But again, yes. This is
the consistency of your sensor with their result, but then you're arguing why you wouldn't trust this sensor.
Yeah, so, but on the other hand, it's maybe too early to fully trust this sensor, because mm-hmm. we were one of the first groups to apply it mm-hmm. right after it was developed. So there should be alternative methods of measuring it.
I fully agree. Yes, yes, of course. Yeah. Okay. Then moving on a bit, it's a more technical question, but I think it relates also to these NADPH oscillations that you observe. On page 65, your S9 calculated the derivative of the concentration of NADPH. And you saw that it's in antiphase with the volume. And that was another interesting figure because it started to make me think that the concentration dynamics only contains the volume dynamics. So what is the use of comparing like two variables that are influenced by a common factor, like volume? What could that tell us?
You refer to page 65, right? B.
Yes. S9. Yeah. Panel B.
Yeah, so it's not the volume, it's the derivative of the cell surface area. So the idea was, so of course it is not a convincing piece of evidence. So there is no causality there. It's just a matter of correlation of two signals, the derivative of an NADPH and derivative of cell surface area. What I thought when I saw this is that when cell surface area expansion rate is higher, that is indicative of the lipid biosynthesis upregulated, and then NADPH without parentheses, NADPH is used for lipid biosynthesis, and then this is a nice kind of support for this, but it is only an indication.
Yes, but at the same time, NADPH concentration is affected by the production and the consumption dynamics as well as the volume.
So yeah, you're right. Yeah, so it's maybe. But it's the whole problem and the peculiarity of our field, right? So it's very hard to make the causality statements. So so I just put this figure there because it is a nice observation. But of course, we cannot make any strong conclusion from here.
If I would have time for one question, one more question?
Yeah, a short question, maybe.
Short question. Well, you can give a short answer. I mean, but I wanted to ask. So you talk about the negative feedback as a possibility for generating these oscillations. But then it's very amazing. I find it amazing that basically all the processes are going full speed in Z2. It's the phase where the maximal activity is taking place. So how do you think this is possible, and why is it not possible in Z1?
Yeah, this is indicative of another player possibly being involved that allows this to happen in G1 but not in G2M. So this is not clear yet. Yeah, so this might be the cyclin-dependent kinase playing there. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So cell cycle metabolism could indeed...
Yeah, interact, because of course there are multiple directions of interaction between these two parts, metabolism and cell cycle.
Thank you for the answer.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, then we go to the last opponent, that is Professor Slotboom.
Dear candidate, you've written a fantastic thesis, and I think you have pushed the boundaries of what I would call analytical chemistry. Push the boundaries by being creative and using the technological state of the art. So very well done. Now, I can't help asking this question, and maybe I'm over-interpreting some parts, but or at least one particular part, but are there hidden or secret messages in your thesis?
Highly learned opponent, thanks a lot for your words. Yeah, there is one, at least one secret message that I can unleash right now. This is on the back side of the book. So life is dynamic. So this is just to summarize what I was doing. So dynamic nature of metabolism, what we tried to measure, but at the same time, my experience as a person of doing this PhD, a dynamical experience.
All right. So maybe I misread it, but I think that some of the letters were in the wrong order. But maybe that was the secret message. I can talk about that later. I was triggered early on by a question of Professor Teusing, and you answered that there are many cells, like in our bodies, that do not grow and divide. And that's in relation to metabolism, that they still have metabolism. But then I noticed that on page 13 of your thesis, as well as on page, I think it's 32, you explicitly state that, well, on page 32, metabolism provides energy and building blocks for cell growth. And on page 13, you state, as growth rate represents the ultimate product of each cell's metabolism. Now, I wonder how you see this in the light of these cells that do not grow and divide.
So that is an interesting question. So indeed, the growth of a cell, which is the expansion in size and increase in mass, is the product of metabolic activity, right? And you refer to the fact that also non-cells...
I can interrupt you because you say it's the product of metabolic activity, but you could say it's a product.
Yeah, you're right. That is a good note. Yeah, I agree with you. It is a product of metabolism because there's a multitude of other products, right? The release of ethanol, which is completely counterproductive with regards to growth. And this is with the purpose of combating bacteria around. It is a product of metabolism.
Thank you very much. We can discuss this later.
Thank you. Het college voor promoties zal ze nu enkele ogenblikken terugtrekken voor beraad. Meneer de promovendus, het college voor promoties van deze universiteit, door ons vertegenwoordigd, naar kennis te genomen hebben van uw proefschrift met bijgevoerde stellingen en deze door u te hebben horen verdedigen, heeft besloten u het door u begeerde doctoraat aan de Rijksuniversiteit Groningen te verlenen. Uw promotor, de hoogleraar Heineman, is gemachtigd u op de gebruikelijke wijze met deze waardigheid te bekleden.
Volgaarne aanvaard ik de taak mij door de rector magnificus is opgedragen. Doch alvorens deze opdracht uit te voeren, wil ik enige persoonlijke woorden tot u richten. Dear Vakil, this laudatio is supposed to be 6 minutes. But there's so much things to tell about you that I guess the 6 minutes will not suffice. But I guess with your foresight, you already booked the late evening defense slot. There's no more defense coming. And I guess my colleagues also do not have any further appointments today. So I'll skip this rule. I will talk probably a bit longer. We met a few years ago. I mean, I was very fortunate to secure funding for an European ITN project, the network MetaRNA. And together with other European partners, we could hire 15 students into this network. A broad advertisement led to about 300 applicants. Out of the 300 applicants, we invited 25 to a recruitment day in Amsterdam, where I first met you. At the time, you had almost finished your master's in bioengineering and bioinformatics from Moscow University. and now did your master project in Leiden. You expressed a very, very broad interest, ranging from fundamental science up to entrepreneurial activity. And my first thought, well, that this sounds a bit undecided, you know, this broad range of interests. But I guess at the moment of time, I explained this with your young age. And I guess you were 17 or maybe 18? No. So you're very, very, very young. Anyway, you were certain about one thing, and that was that you wanted to do work that had potential for impact. And at the end of the recruitment days, I think you were a top-ranked candidate, and in fact, several of the involved PIs wanted to recruit you to their lab. And I still remember when I went out from the room with the PIs, get to approach you and ask you, Vakil, you now have been offered positions in these three labs. Which one are you gonna would like to choose? And you immediately said, I would like to choose your lab, Matthias. And I was super happy. I was in heaven, actually. So when you started, our aim was to learn more about the metabolic oscillations in single yeasts. And from the literature, you gathered many different FRET sensors and supported with bachelor and master students. You cloned them, tested them, and so on and so forth. And this was a very time-consuming exercise. And furthermore, and we talked about this today also, it was very frustrating as none of the sensors really worked. And this was not because of you, but probably because many of the published sensors were not as thoroughly validated and tested as you did. And only part of all your efforts with regard to these activities finally made it into your thesis. And I think your pyrate chapter, pyrate FRET chapter, should serve as a matter of as a note of caution. And then together with Alvarum, a former postdoc in the lab, you further engaged with the lab's effort to develop RNA-based sensors for our favorite metabolite, fructose bisphosphate. And initially, Alvaro needed help with a huge amount of sequencing data, where your bioinformatics expertise was really greatly needed. But very quickly, you fully rolled into the project. You experimentally developed and tested new variants, performed additional experiments, gave the story new twists, so that finally, this was also part, an important part of your project. Now you're doing some final calibration, and then hopefully off the story will go again, hopefully with a bit more luck this time. And over the years, your big research question was, what is metabolism actually doing during the cell cycle? Which pathways are active at which moment? And this is an absolutely non-trivial question, which actually has been open since 1969, where Caspar von Meyenburg first described the metabolic oscillations. And the challenge is enormous. And in fact, to answer this question, it was necessary to not only determine the activity of metabolic pathways, which is already a non-trivial task, but you also needed to do this when these activities are actually dynamic, which is even a much bigger issue, or a much bigger challenge. So you had to come up with a new approach. And while earlier it was conjectured that these metabolic oscillations might originate in respiration, you found that these oscillations in fact occurred in all different nutrients that you've tested, including YPD medium. And this observation, I think, started us to believe or to think that these oscillations might originate in biosynthesis. I don't fully recall when this idea, when we zoomed into biosynthesis, but I think it was definitely emerged from the many excellent discussions that we had. But how could this now be tested? Whether lipid protein storage metabolism activities would be dynamic? For proteins, it was relatively straightforward, also something that we've discussed. It sounds straightforward, but it required highly sophisticated analysis of dynamic microscopy data, segmenting cells, taking derivatives, and so on and so forth, until you found there is actually two peaks, one in G1 and one in the middle of SG2M, which goes completely counter to the current notion in the field, where people still would believe that this just goes smoothly, exponentially through the cell cycle. But how could we validate this? How to determine the temporal activity of other biosynthetic rates? And here you came up with an extremely clever experiment. To grow cells in a microfluidic device, you dynamically added an inhibitor of a particular biosynthetic process, while you constantly monitored the NADPH dynamics, and through, again, highly sophisticated analysis of energy pH dynamics and cell cycle stages. You determined the rate of change in the energy pH dynamics, which upon the addition of inhibitors. And this rate serves as a proxy for the momentary activity of the perturbed biosynthetic process. With this type of experiments, you could confirm the two protein synthesis waves and found that the lipid synthesis has only one, namely NG1. And these analyses were extremely, very complex and super time consuming. And my estimate would be that one round of such an experiment from the peak cultures up until to a plot that shows some data would take about 1 month, involving activities such as boring clicking of cells, handling noise in the data, taking derivatives, aligning data, and so on and so forth. And I think that this 1 month estimate is actually a complete PI type underestimation of work that it takes, right? But then you had one and the replicate yet another month, another replicate yet another month, and there the time goes. Yet these experiments excellently demonstrate two of your key characteristics, Akhil. First, your creativity. The idea underlying these experiments is beautiful and elegant and serves indeed as a strong evidence for your creativity. But second, it also demonstrates your persistence. And after 1 month of hard work and tedious, you find out that there's one cannot really see something in the data because there were too many cells. You had to push yourself through doing it again and doing it again and doing it again. And I think many other would have given up, but you were convinced that there's something and you made it happen. And the same happened to you when, together with your colleague Caserta, you integrated qualitative data into a mathematical model. Again, endless number of iterations, refinements, improvements were necessary. And together, you always further pushed the boundaries of what is possible. With the boundaries that you pushed, Vakil, we now know that the metabolic oscillations during the cell cycle likely originate from the temporally segregated activities of in the biosynthetic processes. And in essence, you answered a long-standing question. One, where the metabolic oscillations actually come from. And together with our lab's earlier finding that these oscillations are cell cycle autonomous, your work actually suggests, and also this is what we have discussed today, that the biosynthetic processes actually together form an oscillator. And I would say that with this, you've done amazing work, which will have significant impact. Not only are several projects in the lab today actually follow-up projects of yours, now looking into the mechanism of this oscillator, but more importantly, you uncovered the temporally segregated biosynthetic dynamics, and the respective oscillator mechanism might be actually at the very basis of cell growth and division. And as such, I hope that in a few years that will end up in the textbooks. All of this you accomplished on the basis of several traits. It still goes on for two pages here. Still important traits and characteristics. With the creativity and the persistence, I already mentioned two important ones, but there's several more. First, you're an excellent communicator. You have a perfect feel of what your audience knows and does not know. And I think it's almost famous now in the lab, your funnel type structure of how you move people to the point that you want to make. You always take your audience fully on board, and I think I've never met anybody who has so excellent communication skills. But you're not only excellent communicating in bilateral discussions and meetings, but you're also very good in outreach. I just want to mention that you participated in several competitions. I remember that you won the first prize in the 3 minutes thesis award at this university. You made it in, you won the regional finals of the FameLab competition. You made it into the nationals of the FameLab competitions. And for all of those in the audience who haven't seen Vakil, any of Vakil's presentation, use YouTube and go and look for them. And of course, I also should not forget to mention your 3 poster awards, where you mentioned that there's a secret to win awards, a poster award, which is the black background, right? The dark background, that's. One of your other important characteristics is that you're extremely reliable. Not only would you do always what you promised and also in the indicated time frame, but furthermore, you will always double and triple check everything to make sure that there's nothing overlooked. And this thoroughness in all what you do, ranging from very detailed and highly accurate descriptions in your figure captions, there it's again, up to the documentation and organization of your files, is something that advisors really, really appreciate, because it gives us a peace of mind that things are all right. And finally, you're a master of both experimental and computational work, ranging from statistics into modeling, at an extremely high level, and I would not know anything that you could not do. This is something that's very rare to find in individual scientists, and I think that's a very, very strong asset. Finally, also a super nice person, Akhil. I think I never experienced you in a bad mood. You're always very cheerful, and it's never boring to hang around with you. You can have excellent discussions with you about all different kinds of topics. And also, your openness is great. Whenever there's something that bugged you, you would always come and talk to me about this. And I really like and appreciate this a lot. With these traits and characteristics, you're excellently equipped for everything that you will do in the future. Whatever it will be, you will be excellently equipped. And likely, your next step will be a postdoc in Zurich. And it would not surprise me if at some point you will start up your own lab. You have it all in yourself. Akhil, now I likely talked twice as long as I should, and I should stop now. But before doing so, I would like to say thank you first to the members of the reading committee, Professor Teusink, Professor van der Klei, Professor Pohlmann, and second to all the members of the defense committee today for a very lively and excellent discussion. And finally, I would like to thank you, Akhil, for all what you did. Most importantly, I'd like to thank you that you have chosen me as advisor at this very one afternoon in Amsterdam. The interactions with you had been an amazing experience. It was great to see you to further develop and grow, and I'm honored that I could have been your advisor. Thank you very much. Uit kracht van de bevoegdheid. Uit kracht van de bevoegdheid, ons bij de wet toegekend volgens het besluit van het College voor Promoties van deze universiteit, verklaar ik, Matthias Heineman, u, Akhil Takayev, te bevorderen tot dokter en u alle rechten te verlenen die door wet of gewoonte aan het doctoraat aan de Rijksuniversiteit Groningen zijn verbonden. Belooft u als dokter in de toekomst te handelen naar de Nederlandse gedragscode wetenschapsbeoefening? Nadat ik alzo de mij opgelegde taak heb volbracht, mag ik de eerste zijn die u met deze promotie geluk wenst en u als dokter begroet. Congratulations, Akhil.
Ten bewijs van deze promotie overhandig ik diploma door rector magnificus, secretaris en promotor ondertekend en voorzien van het grootzegel van deze universiteit. Toch, alvorens daartoe over te gaan, zeer geleerde heer, kwijt ik mij van een aangename plicht om u, mede namens het college voor promoties, met de zojuist geworven graad geluk te wensen. Zo, hier is your long delayed thesis. Please, look. And you also get a booklet, and Matthias promised later on to write something in it, but in the meantime, I had some time left over to make a small note in the corner here. But this is as a remembrance for the special day, and later on. En dan verklaar ik hierbij deze promotieplechtigheid voor geëindigd.